before me. I am not moved by what I hear. What a doctor says is not of God, yeah. You say like you mean it. I am not moved by what I feel. Yeah, that's it. He feels it all. He's felt it all. He's gone before me. Yeah. I am not moved. I can never be moved. By what I see or hear, he knows it all. He's gone before. Thank you.
I don't know about you guys, but y'all a little bit too quiet for me, because I heard today is a wonderful day to give the Lord thanks and praise, because it's our birthday, Beacon Light. It's our birthday. We thought we were something when we made 18, but word on the street, we made 21. Give God glory. Give God honor. Give God praise. Hallelujah. For 21 years in a tri-parish area. Good morning, good morning, good morning, Beacon Light of Houma. We are so grateful to have you in the house of the Lord on today, for it is in this place where we hear, receive, and impart the word of God into our lives and into our hearts, to bless our families, to bless our communities. We give God praise. Hallelujah. So welcome to you, our 9 a.m. worshipers. Welcome to you, our virtual workers, worshipers. We are so excited to have you view the gospel with us. We're so grateful that you tune in week by week to hear the word of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, we come to you. We bless you. We honor you and we praise you. For this is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and we will be glad in it, God. Lord, we thank you for covering our bishop and our first lady. We thank you for every leader that's represented in the body of Christ today. We thank you for our members, God, because we couldn't do anything that we do in this house without the people, oh God.
Father God, I come to you to just say thank you. I'm not coming to thank you for what you have done, but I'm coming to thank you for who you are. Father God, I thank you because you're a way maker. You make a way out of no way, even when we don't deserve it, Father. For that, I say thank you. God, I want to thank you because you're a rock. You're my fortress. God, I want to thank you because we get not what we deserve, but we get the grace, and your grace is just so sufficient. God, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for all you've done for us, all you're going to continue to do for us. Lord, I want to thank you that you're my rock in a weary land. Lord, I want to thank you that you've just blessed me and kept me. Lord, you made death behave. Lord, you took sickness. Restoration has been ours, Lord, and I want to thank you. Lord, we want to just say, there is none like you, Lord. When the work is done, God, I just want to hear servant of God, well done. Lord, I ask these blessings and all other blessings in your darling son, Jesus' name. Amen.
What a beautiful name it is, the name.
Father, Abba, how it is we thank you, how it is we bless you, how it is we praise you. praise you. We magnify your holy name. Give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Open the eyes of our heart that we may see the fullness of Christ and walk in his grace and power. Meet us at our point of need on today and fill those needs with your endless grace. Thank you, Lord. Bless you and praise you. Father, we are 21 now, a legal age. So therefore, we will stand as adults in your kingdom and profess that which you say to profess. So we thank you that our community is blessed because of Beacon Light. We thank you that our families are blessed because of Christ. We thank you that our health is blessed because of Christ. We thank you that we are all that you said we are because of Christ. We stand as adults and call in those who need to grow up, Lord. We stand as adults, Lord, and bless your name through your word, through your song, Lord. Accept our praise on this morning and the meditations of our heart, that it will be acceptable in your sight, because we are yours and you are ours. In Jesus' mighty, blessed name we pray.
What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King.
What a beautiful name,
what a beautiful name it is.
Nothing compares to this,
nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of
what a beautiful name.
What a beautiful name it is.
Cast down the spirit
a spirit of personality. You better not be praising because I'm up here. You better be praising because you know the God that you serve. We're not here to praise a person. We're here to praise the person, the one and only, Jesus Christ. Open your mouth for your Savior, for your Redeemer, for your Deliverer. Hey! You're going to have to excuse our music ministry. We had an experience in our rehearsal, and this is just the residue of that experience. So why don't you come on and join us as we continue to praise our God. As we continue. Hallelujah. This isn't about an event. This is about a lifestyle. This is about our hearts. This is about what flows like rivers. Rivers of living water. Rivers of living water. I say the Lord is high above the heavens.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
And His glory above the nation.
And His glory above the nation.
Oh, yes, the Lord is high above the heavens.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
And His glory above the nation.
And His glory
above
the nation. Say that. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah means we came to celebrate, to acknowledge, to esteem, to honor the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. We wouldn't be here without Jesus. I don't care if you've been saved your whole life. Never let it get old, the sacrifice that Jesus made for you. Because it was a choice. God didn't force Jesus on the cross. The Bible said he gave himself. How could you not give glory and honor and praise to one that gave their lives for you? I challenge you today. Forget that it's the 21st anniversary. Maybe it's your 21st year being saved. That's enough to praise him. Maybe it's your 21st day of your healing. That's enough to praise him. Maybe it's been 20 months since you've been sober. That's enough to praise him. Why don't you lift your hands all over this place? We're not here to sing the latest songs. I don't care to excite the crowd. Lord, I just want to make you smile. It doesn't matter if you think I'm right or wrong. You might want to call me down, but I've just come to praise him now. For you covered me
in the midst of it all.
Yes, God.
You love me. You gave me another chance. You saw my needs when others saw my faults. You forgave me.
You don't have to listen for my name. You don't have to walk me down and out. Lord, I just want to make you smile. And if I make the Hall of Fame, oh, they want to save a special seat. I just want to praise you. Say, in my life. Take all the honor, oh God.
Place the Lord has done marvelous things for us. If that is your declaration, lift your hands and just say, Father, you get all the glory. You get all the honor in our life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. Father, we thank you now, Father, for your marvelous works that it is that you're doing it through our life, Father God. Continue to have your way in and through us, Father God. For you have declared, he that knew no sin became sin for us, Father God. So, Father God, we thank you now just for that sacrifice that it is that you did on that cross, Father God. For you did not have to do it, Father. So we just say thank you one more time, Father God, for what it is that you have done. Father, we love you. We thank you. That's it. You get all the praise, Father.
You take the honor.
Everything in our life. Hallelujah.
We want to say thank you.
Oh, we just want to thank you, Father.
You get the glory.
You get the praise.
You get the praise. You take the honor.
Hallelujah, family. This is a perfect time to give thanks to the perfect gift that he gave us. That is his Holy Communion. If you have the ability all over this place, if you can, let's stand as we prepare to receive now the precious gift that our Father gave us when Jesus Christ died upon that cross. He said the very bread that we hold in our hands, he declared that this represents his body, which was given to us as a sacrifice. And in and through that sacrifice, anything that we may stand in need of, it's all right here in our hands. So I'll give you a moment just to think about what it is that you may need. Is it sickness? If you need healing, restoration in your mind, whatever it is, you put that on your mind right now. And as you hold that bread, what Jesus said represents his body, which was given to us, I want you to now, as we prepare to consume it, see that particular thing on that cross. And as it's on that cross, know that it was buried with Jesus. So, Father God, on that very same night, when you took bread, you blessed it, you broke it, you gave it to each one of your disciples, and you said, take, eat, for this represents my body. Family, let's consume the body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus
you
Christ.
You get the glory. You get the praise.
You get the praise.
You take the honor.
You take the honor.
We'll forever say thank you.
Lord, we thank you now for your blood. For what could wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
What makes me whole? Nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ. What makes me righteous? Nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ. What gives me a peace that surpasses all understanding? Nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ. So, Father, now we just say thank you for that blood that you have given us, Father. For how it has redeemed us, washed us, made us new. So, family, if you can now, let's consume the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you. You get the glory.
You get the glory. You get the praise.
You take the honor.
You take the honor.
Can I get everybody to just lift your hands right where you are? Come on, lift your hands right here. Hallelujah. Open up your mouth and declare unto the Lord, you get the glory. Come on, y'all.
You get the glory.
Come on, everybody, declare it today.
You get the praise.
Hallelujah.
You take the honor.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's just tell him thank you. Come on. Thank you.
Thank
Come on,
you.
Everybody, tell him thank you today.
Thank
Come on, if you have
Lord,
if you have anything to be grateful for,
you.
Come on, open up your mouth. Come on. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Now do me a favor. We haven't done this in a while. But while our musicians are playing, I need you to get out of your seat and find about three people and just witness to them and let them know that the God we serve, He is an awesome God. He is a mighty God. He is a victorious God. Come on, move out from where you are.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Come on, y'all. We're going to shut it down in a moment. But somebody say thank you.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Yeah, we come to say thank you, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Hallelujah.
Lord.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Come on, lift those hands right here. This is it right here. Come on, y'all. Give him a wave offering right here. Hallelujah. Come on, you're telling him that he gets the glory. Come on, give it to him right now. Come on, you get the glory.
You get the glory.
You get the praise.
You get the praise.
You take the honor.
Hallelujah. This is the last time. This is the last time. As a mass choir, everybody, you get the glory.
Glory.
Come on, everybody, you get the praise.
You get the praise.
Come on, you get the honor.
You take the honor.
Well, can I get somebody to go ahead and give him praise? Can I get somebody to shout like you know
Hallelujah.
That you know that you know that you know that we serve an amazing God?
Hallelujah.
Somebody shout glory.
Glory.
I don't know about you, but I was glad when they said unto me, come, let us go into the house of the Lord. Give somebody a high five and tell them, welcome to God's house. No, come on, let them know this ain't man's house.
Hallelujah.
This is God's house.
And we give you glory. And we give you glory.
A house of miracles. A house of signs. A house of wonders. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How awesome is our God. How awesome is our God. If you know that we serve an amazing God, go ahead one more time and give him praise. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. The city of our God, and in the mountain of his holiness. You know, when El Diana, stood up here, it took me back 21 years when the Lord told my pastor to start a church in Houma, Louisiana called the Beacon Light Church of Houma. I could remember we would be riding in the van to come do Tuesday night Bible study, and El Diana would be in the back with Ale, her little baby. 21 years ago. And after she and I had the wonderful privilege of ministering together for almost 20 years, the enemy attacked her body. And I can remember the first Sunday that the Lord brought us back into this place. I can remember standing right here And I said that Elder Yana, her body is under attack, and she's not with us right now. I said, but if I be a man of God, I say, I promise you that one day soon, she gonna be standing right back on this stage, ushering us into the presence of our God. Will you look at somebody and tell them that day has come? No, come on, y'all, tell them that day has come. Why? Because our God is a healer. Why? Because our God is a promise keeper. Why? Because there's nobody greater. There's nobody. Hallelujah.
Nobody. Hallelujah. Greater.
Come on, somebody declare nobody.
Nobody greater.
Come on, nobody.
Nobody greater than you.
Oh, y'all, it's our birthday party. We might as well go ahead and celebrate. Nobody.
Nobody greater.
Come on, nobody.
Nobody greater.
There's nobody.
Nobody greater than you.
Hallelujah. One more time. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Come on, nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody.
Nobody greater than you.
Well, come on and bless our great God. That's all right if you praising me, but I ain't the one. No, give it to God. Give it to our Father. He is great. You know, it does matter where you go to church.
Yes, indeed.
Heard that in my spirit. I said it does matter where you go to church. I ain't putting down nobody. I'm just saying. Come on, nudge your neighbor and say, he's just saying. No, it matters where you go to church, especially in this season. In this season, you can't just be running to a church because they got a good choir. You can't just be running to a church because the preacher can hoop. No, in this season, you better be seeking the anointing of God. In this season, you need to be in a place of unified rest. Everybody say rest. You need to be in a place where there is a fresh anointing that is flowing over the lives of the people. Come on, lift your hands right where you are. You need to be in a place where the anointing of God is manifesting as favor from the sanctuary of God that is descending upon the people of grace, descending upon the place of grace. You need to be in a place where there is a commanded blessing of life. Everybody shout life.
Life.
Come on, y'all, shout it strong. Say life,
life.
Evermore. In this season, you better be in a church where there's great grace, great power, and great blessings. Come on, family, let's put it in the atmosphere. Everybody say great grace, great power, and great blessings. A place where the lives of the people testify to the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. In this season, you need to be in a place where the anointing is so thick that no one connected to the anointing will experience any lack of any kind. Everybody say, no lack of any kind. In Beacon Light, God says, we're in that place. Will y'all go ahead and give him praise for it?
Your name, yeah, is above all names.
Hallelujah.
You're worthy of praise.
Hallelujah. Come on, y'all. Mighty, like everybody like that. Come on. Come on, mighty are the works. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say that one more time. Come on, your name. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater. Nobody greater than you.
Hallelujah. Now I need everybody to sing that, and we're going to do it without the music. Nobody.
Nobody greater.
Come on, everybody. Nobody.
Nobody greater.
There's nobody.
Nobody greater than you.
Well, come on. Let's celebrate the Lord as you take your seats. Hallelujah. He's a great God. He's an awesome God. He is great, and he is so greatly deserving of our praise. God bless you, Beacon Light friends and family, all who are sharing today on this beautiful, 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 amazing, awesome, beautiful day that the Lord has made, a day that we've never seen before and a day that we'll never, ever see again. And because it's a day that the Lord has made, we are doing right by giving his name praise, giving his name honor, and giving his name glory. Can I get all of the new creations in Christ to put your hands together and celebrate your God? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We certainly thank God today for all who are sharing today, both in-house and, of course, on our virtual platform. We greet all of you in the mighty, in the strong name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, for it is in him that we live, it is in him that we move, it is in him that we have our being. I, of course, am so excited again to see so many beautiful people here in the house of the Lord, but of course we always give honor to whom honor is due. And with that being said, would y'all help me to celebrate the presence of my partner in life, my partner in ministry, Elder Lynette. Amen. Certainly thank God for her, and we thank God again for all of the people of God who are sharing here as we come today to celebrate Jesus, hallelujah, and to celebrate what he has given unto us, this place called Beacon Light, 21 years. Come on, y'all, thank God for that, 21 years. 21 years, I believe Elder West said it best. We grown up now, y'all, amen. We grown folk around here, amen. And we are excited about it. It took us 20 years before we really knew who we were in Christ Jesus. We were searching. We were searching. Even as a pastor, I was searching because I knew that there was so much more that God had to offer besides what we were experiencing. So much more than just talking about miracles. A miracle is coming. A miracle is coming. Well, the truth of the matter is, it's already here. Hallelujah. And God, our Father, he has allowed us just in this year. I was meditating on this just yesterday, and the Lord began to take me back through this year. So many wonderful things he has done. Miracles, signs, and wonders, different areas, financially. The Lord brought me back to a young lady right when they said that they're no longer forgiving student loans. A few days later, she got an $84,000 debt canceled. A couple weeks after that, another one of our family members said that they heard the testimony of that debt cancellation, and they got super excited, celebrated with them, but was believing God for their debt cancellation, only to have a $54,000 debt canceled. Hallelujah. We've seen it all. One sister had a 2-centimeter spot on her kidneys that was confirmed through 2 separate ultrasounds. But by the time she went for treatment, the doctor said, the spot is gone, and it looks like you have a brand new kidney. Another young brother, somebody had slipped something on him. So he's in the hospital, unconscious. His family, being nursing professionals, are looking at the readings on the monitors, and they know that the monitors are saying the boy has already begun to die. And then in 24 hours, the Lord flipped the script. Come on, y'all. So much so that the president of the hospital called and said, what in the world was it? How did that happen? Another young brother, baby, y'all got it. Put a Braylon with the burn. The boy had burns. And was in the hospital for less than 7 days. Talked to his mother, and we agreed to believe God for not just his healing, because when you get healed from a burn, there's still going to be all of these scars. So we were believing God that he'd be healed with no scars. And in less than 7 days, somebody shout 7 days. In less than 7 days, the boy was on his way home with no bandages. And come on, show the results. Will y'all please show the results? Come on, y'all. Oh, it does matter where you go to church. Or you can say what you want. It does matter. Just last week, another young brother, teenager, got scoliosis. And his spine was curved 43%. Show that picture for me, please. Yeah, that's his spine. Not the first one. That's it. That's where he was at 43%. On his way to 50%, at which time surgery would have to be performed. The boy got frustrated, stopped wearing the brace that the doctors gave him, because he wore the brace for about 4 months and the situation got worse. So he stopped wearing the brace. But his mother said she held on to her sword. I know if you're a visitor, you may not know what we're talking about, but will you encourage somebody and tell them, hold on to your sword. She said they went back to the hospital. The doctor took another x-ray, and the boy's spine was curved at 43%. And this is what the doctor found when he went back. Come on, y'all. Will y'all give God praise? It does matter. It matters, y'all. Thank you. It does matter where you go to church. We're not taking any credit for any of this, because I ain't lay my hands on nobody.
That's it right there. That's it.
The people are taking the word of grace. They're bringing it home. And they ain't talking about what's going to happen. They are celebrating what has already happened. And they are seeing the manifestations of the blessings of God in their lives on a consistent basis. Hallelujah. So in this season, I know that might be the church that your mom and them went to. But if they ain't teaching you the word of grace, you better pack your bags, put up your little church finger, and ease on up. Because the Bible says, everybody say, the Bible says that it is the word of his grace that will build you up. It is the word of his grace that will give you your inheritance. No. He didn't say you'd have to earn it. He said it will give you your inheritance. I'll say this and we'll move on. See, the reason why the word of grace gives you your inheritance is because it teaches you how righteous you are because of the finished work of Jesus. You're not righteous because of what you do. You're righteous because of what he has done. And when you get a revelation of righteousness, when you get a revelation of how righteous you are because of what Jesus has done, righteousness is like a magnet. That's what the Lord showed me. A couple of days I was meditating on righteousness. And the Lord says, son, righteousness is like a magnet. Any of you, when you were younger, I know my uncle and I, we used to get a magnet. And on one side of the magnet, it would draw and connect to metal. But then if you flipped it over to the other side, it will feel like it's repelling the metal. One side, it goes to the metal. The other side, it repels the metal. And the Lord says, son, that's just how righteousness is. He says, righteousness is like a magnet. It draws the blessings of God to you. It draws the wonders of God into your life. But as it's drawing the blessings into your life, that same righteousness will repel that which the enemy attempts to bring. And you'll find yourself walking in and seeing the grace of God manifesting as great power and manifesting as great blessings in your life. Everybody lift your hands. We'll do this and then we'll move on. Lift your hands in the receiving position. Father, now in the name of Jesus, I thank you and I praise you. We declare that you are our God. You are our peace. You are our strength. You are our righteousness. And we thank you, Father, that you have given unto us the abundance of grace. You have given unto us the gift of righteousness. And because of that, we, your people, we reign in this life. We reign over sickness. We reign over lack. We reign over worry, fear, stress. And we receive all of the blessings and the benefits that are already provided through the finished work of Jesus. So today, Father, in the midst of this celebration, we say thank you. Thank you for this place called the Beacon Light Church of Houma, Louisiana. We honor you, bless you, and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, bless him one more time, family. Amen. At this time, we're going to, right before we give, we're going to receive our church history because, you know, it's hard to go forward if you don't know where we've come from. So we're going to receive the church history and then immediately after that, we will, of course, share in worship through giving and receive the word of his grace. Would you receive Elder Ruffin, Elder Janet Ruffin, our church historian? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This woman of God know the church history better than me. Hallelujah. We certainly thank God for Elder Ruffin.
Good morning. Of course, we give honor to God, our maker, our creator, to Bishop and to his partner, Elder Andrew, and to our speaker for today, Bishop Pierce and Lady Pierce. And to our family. Beacon Light, past, present, and future. Our journey of faith is filled with milestones, and today we celebrate that remarkable journey. Today, as we celebrate, we reflect on the past, we embrace the present, and we envision the future filled with God's grace as we journey through this year of the sword. We recommit ourselves to the vision of spreading love, compassion, and hope. As we commemorate the milestone, we carry the flame of faith as we continue to be a light in this community, in the Tri-Parish area, and around the world. 21 years is a testament to the enduring power of God's love and the unwavering dedication of his people. Our anniversary is a celebration of God's faithfulness as he has led us through challenges and he has blessed us abundantly. We are reminded that we are called to be the hands and the feet of Christ. On this anniversary, we honor the sacred ground that we stand on and the sacred purpose that unites us as a family. We celebrate the faith that binds us. We celebrate the hope that sustains us. And we celebrate the love that unites us. On this special day, we honor the visionary who laid the foundation of our church. I will stand upon my watch and set upon the tower, and I will watch to see what he says to me. And the Lord said to me, write the vision. Make it plain so that all would be fulfilling it. They could read it and run with it in its appointed time. The Lord gave that revelation to our apostle and overseer, Bishop Darrell Brister, an answer for the age. When God says something, it will be done, and it will be done the way he wants it to be done, and it will be done in his time. Record the vision. Write it down. Record it legibly. Make it plain, record it permanently. It's for the future. With that vision, Bishop Brister arrived in Houma, September 2002, bringing a new voice and a new spirit of hope. The starting point was a crusade held at the Houma Terrebonne Civic Center on Friday night and Saturday morning. The center was full. The word was ministered, souls were saved, and people were healed. 1 month later, on October 1st, Bible study began at the Hampton Inn in Houma. Week after week on Tuesday night, the attendance grew. We relocated to the Holiday Inn, but we outgrew the Holodome, so we moved to Ramada Inn. Our first home was purchased at 214 Enterprise Drive. And we also purchased a modular building for our children to be ministered to and to be taught while adults were being ministered to in the church. Our apostle brought with him to Houma a young man named Elder Herbert Andrew. Reluctant to come to Houma, Elder Andrew understood that his assignment was to go where the people needed to hear a relevant word to help them in their situations. That reluctance turned into a relationship. And now he finds it hard to stay away from Houma for too long. He fell in love with us, and now he can't let go. He was installed as pastor in April of 2003, joined by his wife, Lady Lynette Andrew. A few years later, Pastor Andrew was installed as Bishop Andrew. And a few years later, Lady Lynette Andrew was ordained as an elder. Because healthy things grow, our continued growth prompted the need for a larger place to worship. And on December 31st, 2009, we celebrated bringing in the new year, 2010, here in our new sanctuary. A few years later, we purchased an additional 13 acres of land. Healthy things grow. In spite of the years of closure during the pandemic, we held on because the vision remained in our hearts. We've had so many shining moments. God's favor is bestowed upon us. He is king over this house of prayer, and the Holy Spirit governs this ministry. The beauty of our church lies not in the walls, but in the love that binds us. These walls are built not with bricks, but with our unwavering faith. Every step we take is guided by God's grace. In the embrace of faith, we find courage. In our fellowship, we find strength. When we gather in His name, miracles happen. Lives are transformed, hearts amended, dreams are realized, and souls are saved through the power of God's love. The spirit of gratitude fills our hearts as we reflect on the countless blessings that we've received through this journey. In the tapestry of our church's journey, each milestone represents a thread of faith, a thread of hope, and a thread of love interwoven by God's grace. So we celebrate today this milestone. We are reminded that the true measure of our church's success lies in the lives that we touch and the love that we share. In a world filled with chaos, we stand as an oasis of peace, where weary souls find rest, and where hope is restored. Our faith has carried us through the storms, our faith has strengthened us through adversity, and our faith has strengthened, given us a united family. From the very beginning, in 2003, God kept His promises of providing us with unusual opportunities. In 2010, we continued to walk in newness, and through the years, 2011, we dared to be different. 2018, we experienced righteous renewal. Last year, 2020, recognizing God's grace and its power. And now in 2021, our year of the sword. In unity, we will continue to find strength. In faith, we will continue to find hope. We remember that a church is not just a building, it is a sanctuary where hearts find comfort and consolation, and souls find purpose. Through trials and triumphs, we have stood the test of time. The flame of devotion will continue to burn brightly within our church, And the seeds of faith we sow today will blossom into a garden of hope, inspiring generations to come in the future. The light of faith will continue to illuminate our path as we march forward hand in hand into another year of blessing. As we look back on the past, we're filled with gratitude. As we look to the future, we are filled with hope. We will continue to let the melodies of worship echo through the walls and through the halls of our church as we celebrate the harmony of faith and community. We will continue to be a beacon of hope in this community. Together, we're stronger. Together, we can make a difference, and together, we can change this world. May the love that binds us grow deeper with each passing year, radiating God's grace to all who enter. We will allow this celebration to ignite a spark of passion and renewal in our hearts as we continue to serve our God. So on this special day, we mark another year of our journey. We will be grateful for the blessings of fellowship, worship, and spiritual growth. So we declare that the light of God's presence will continue to illuminate our path. We declare that our legacy of love and service established will inspire generations to walk in the footsteps of Jesus. We declare the love that flows through our church's walls will continue to spill into our community, spreading kindness, compassion, and love. And we declare great grace, great power, great blessings are all over us. Hallelujah, and happy birthday.
Hallelujah. Come on, y'all, let's bless God. For the battle is not yours. Hallelujah. It is the Lord's. Hallelujah. We certainly thank God for Elder Ruffin sharing that the church history with us. And then for Tiara Brown. Come on, let's thank God for Tiara. We certainly bless God for, thank you, for each and every one of them. Deacons, take your places now as we prepare now to give unto the Lord. We're preparing now to enter into the most important part of our worship experience today, as we, after we give and we receive the word of God, amen. The word of God, of course, here at Beacon Light is always the highlight, so we're certainly looking forward to that. And then immediately after the word, I forgot to mention this, I don't know how I did that. Well, y'all bless God for our 10 candidates that are going down in the liquid grave on today. Oh my goodness, I am so excited. I really, really am. I am so excited about that. Amen. I have an opportunity today to baptize my oldest son. Amen, y'all. My oldest son and my oldest grandson. Amen. So if y'all see me step in that pool and then I start just flying out of there, y'all know what's going on. Amen. I'm just being raptured up out of here because the Lord has just been that good to us. Amen. Amen. Listen, family, we're getting ready now to give unto the Lord because we do know and understand the blessing that is attached to us sowing seed into the kingdom of God. We know that the Lord has already declared over our ministry that there is absolutely no lack for anyone of any kind, those who are connected to this anointing. So we understand that, we embrace that, and of course, even as we prepare to give, can you put up, if you would, 2 Corinthians chapter number 8, verse number 9. Can you put that back up for me, please? 2 Corinthians chapter number 8. Here it is. The Bible says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that through his poverty you might become rich." We understand that there was a great exchange made on the cross of Calvary. Jesus didn't just take our sin and give us his righteousness, but he also took our poverty and gave us his riches. So for us as new creations, we're not trying to get rich. We understand that by faith in the finished work of Jesus, we're already rich. So lay your hands on yourself as we prepare to give on today and just simply declare, I'm already rich. Come on, y'all, say it strong like you're not afraid. Say, I'm already rich. Now look at your neighbor and say, act like it. That's what the Lord challenged us to do last week. He said, start acting like it. Because a rich man, a rich woman, is never concerned about giving 10 cents out of $1. Because a rich man, a rich woman, knows and understands that when I give that, there is so much more that is coming to me. So today I want to challenge each and every one of you. The tithe, of course, it is holy unto the Lord. It's never ever the ceiling where we're in. It's always our starting point. But then we give a liberal offering because the Bible says the liberal soul shall be made fat. Thirdly, of course, pastor's love gift. If my wife and I, if we are a blessing to you and you're led by the Spirit of God to sow into our life, you don't have to. But if you're led to do so, do so knowing that God himself has promised you a prophet's reward. And then today, finally, today is our 21st church anniversary. And I'm going to challenge all of you who can, all of you who will, I'm going to challenge you to sow a very special seed over and above your tithes and offering, a seed of only $21. $21, $1 a year to celebrate and to thank God for this place called Beacon Light Church of Houma, Louisiana. Those of you who are sharing online, you know exactly what to do. You know that you give through text to give. You can text to give by just simply texting BLOHT or BLOHO to 28950. You can use our Cash App, of course, which is $BLHOMA. Beacon Light Houma, BLHOUMA. Or, of course, you can use our website, which is www.beaconlightofhouma.org. Or, like many of you continue to do, especially those of you, our family members who are virtual, who are out of state, many of you, you mail in your tithes and offering. You can certainly do that at 4325 West Park Avenue, Gray, Louisiana, 70359. Those of us who are in-house, you have the ability to take advantage of all of those electronic methods as well. We have individuals on both sides of the platform that will serve you if, in fact, you want to use your debit or credit card. Swipe those cards. It's very safe, very secure. They'll help you in that way. And then these awesome men of God, our deacons, they're now passing out the unified offering envelopes. As they would do so, would you receive the envelope that you need? Take a moment, prepare your gifts, and we're going to lift those gifts and consecrate them wholly before our God. Come on, family, let's take a moment and prepare our gifts, and let's celebrate and thank God for how awesome He is in our lives.
God is doing great things. God is doing great things. Great things. Say God is doing great.
God is doing great things.
Yes, He
is. God is doing great things.
All around.
God is doing great things.
Say great things.
Great things.
Declare it over your life. Say it.
Gifts. Let's consecrate them wholly before our God. Heavenly Father, today we thank you and we praise you. We bless you, sir, for giving unto us seed to sow and then giving us such fertile ground to sow it in. It is our prayer, as always, that absolutely no one will suffer for what they are giving. But we decree and declare, Father, that in and through our giving, we, the people of God, we are already blessed. So we thank you for the harvest, 30, 60, 100-fold return. We receive it by faith in Jesus' name. We pray, amen, amen, and amen. Do me a favor, if you would, get up from where you are. Come, lay your gifts on the altar, and let's expect God to do great and awesome things as we sow to the kingdom of God.
God is doing great things. Yes, He is.
God is doing great things.
Say great things.
Believe in grace.
great things.
Say God, God.
Expecting great things, why don't you go ahead and bless him for it in advance? But truly, he is a God who will always honor his word. We certainly thank God again for everyone who have sown seed into the kingdom of God. We know beyond all shadow of doubt that God will return it unto us in the form of money or something that money cannot buy. Can someone say amen to that? Now, with the time that we have remaining, we're right on time. 10:25, we are right on time. We want to today hear a word from the Lord. I text Bishop Pierce on yesterday because I sensed in my spirit that the Lord was not giving him a word for this occasion. But I was sensing in my spirit that the Lord had already given that word to him. So I'm expecting today, and I want all of you to stand on tiptoe in anticipation and expectation as well, as we receive the man of God who will bless our lives through the word of his grace, the word that is able to build us up and to give us our inheritance. Let me say this before he comes, because I honor this man of God, because he pastored there in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. He pastored a successful ministry for 15 years. Come on, bless God for that. Changing a generation, Full Gospel Baptist Church. And the Lord told him to shut down that ministry, a successful ministry. The Lord told him to shut down that ministry and to come here to Beacon Light of Houma and connect with the anointing here so that he and I can partner together and do great things in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, I'll be honest with you. I don't know if I would have been bold enough to obey God. I'd have been rebuking the devil and everything. Look, devil, you better get thee behind me, Satan. But this man of God, he honored God. He followed the voice of God. And I have no doubt in my mind that what is ahead of him is so much greater than what he walked away from. So I want you all to open up your spirits, open up your hearts, and receive my brother, Bishop Edward Pierce, as he shares the word of grace with us. Come on, give God praise for him as he comes. Hallelujah.
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 Precious Jesus, how I love you. How I lift high my voice with your praise. Say, Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit,
I implore thee.
Come on, lift those hands in the presence of the Lord.
Drench my heart.
Drench my heart.
As my lips part your praise. Say, I am persuaded.
I'm persuaded. Come on, let's worship the presence of God.
To bless.
Father, we declare that my ears are awakened. You've given me the tongue of the learned, that I may speak a word in season to those who may be weary. We thank you for your supernatural victory. We thank you for your rest. We thank you for your peace. We thank you for great grace, great power, great blessing that rests on this house. We give your name glory, praise, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Won't you clap those hands in the presence of the Lord? Come on, y'all can do better than that. Let's bless the name of the Lord. Certainly we give honor to his very presence, and we thank God for my friend and brother, our leader, Bishop Herbert K. Andrew. Let's thank God for him. And I know that what he said is not just words coming out of his mouth, but it does matter where you go to church, especially in this season. Anybody know, my life has been supernaturally shifted, and I always say you can't love the man of God and not love the woman that's on his side. Let's thank God for Elder Lynette, my sister. Amen. And of course, to the woman who stands by my side, who's on this journey with me. Thank God for my wife. She's forever Lady Pierce to me, huh? And certainly we thank God for my wife, Dianca, my wife of over 25 years and 29 years of being together, amen. And she can't get rid of me. And to my oldest, John Paul, he's in the house. My oldest son, my firstborn. Y'all pray for me because he was coaching at Grambling State University on the staff, but he just came down with a new coach, and he's going to be the offensive coordinator at St. Augustine High School. Y'all pray for me, though, because I went to McDonald 35, and you know, that's all in water. So y'all pray for me. Thank God for him. And it's so great to see Deacon Herb. Deacon Herb was my assistant in ministry, and he knew I was coming. He didn't tell me, just showed up. And it's just thank God for he and his wife and daughter. I want to get into my assignment today. I believe that, and I know that God has a word for us. I want to talk about the commanded atmosphere. Somebody say the commanded atmosphere. The Bible says that the heavens, even the heavens, belong to the Lord. But the earth, somebody say the earth, he has given to the children of men. God said, my authority reigns in the heavens in the eternal realm. But within the earth, I placed man there to execute as I did. Everything that God did was with his word. He commanded light to be, and light was. He spoke his word. And so in the earth realm, we must function as God did. So I'm so grateful, and whether you understand it or not, in this year of the sword, it is so vital and critical that we use our sword. It is the spoken word. Somebody say the spoken word. We speak the word. And when we speak
the spirit, the power, the authority gets behind the spoken word. Not the word heard, but the word spoken. And the Bible says in Psalm 119 and 89, he said, "Forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven." The word is settled in heaven, but the word is not settled in earth until a man or a woman hears the settled word from heaven and declare it on earth, and that word is settled. The Bible says that the word out of my mouth shall not return to me void. Y'all hear me this morning? But that word shall accomplish, that word shall prosper in what I sent it to do. It is the return word. Somebody said a return word. I hear God's word and I return it back to him. That's what we are doing in prayer. We take his word, we return it back to him, and that's the word that prospers. That's the word that accomplishes. That's the word that will not be void. That's the word that will not be absent of fruit. From God's mouth is seed. From your mouth it becomes fruit. And so we have to understand that we are the authority within the earth realm. We are the sons of God. And so Isaiah 45 and 11 says this, and I love this word. It says, "Thus says the Lord, the Holy One of Israel and his maker." He said, "Ask me things to come concerning my sons, and concerning the work of my hands, you command me." Notice what he said. He said, "Ask me." He says that means to inquire or request things to come. But notice what he said. He said, "Ask me things to come." Now, this text is written under Old Covenant. Jesus, who was on earth, said that the Holy Spirit, when the Spirit of truth has come, he will guide you into all truth. Isn't that what it said? And he will tell you, watch this, things to come. Somebody say the work hadn't been done yet. The work hadn't been finished. So he was talking about things to come. But I love what 1 Corinthians 2 says, that he says that the Spirit, say the Spirit, say the Holy Spirit will show us what God has freely given to us. Say, we're no longer asking what is to come. We're asking what has been freely given. Come on, that's the shift. That's the shift. Say, we're under the new covenant. And so we're asking of things that have already been given unto us through the finished work of Jesus Christ. And notice what he said. He said, "Ask me things to come concerning my sons." Oh, that's so powerful right there. You've got to understand we are sons of God. We're not talking gender. It's one with the nature and character. We are sons of God. He said we become sons through faith in Jesus. We placed our faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ, and now we are sons of God, not by something we do, but by a position we receive. It is through salvation. So Jesus was the only begotten, but now there are many sons. And God says, "I spoke through my prophets," according to Hebrews, "but now I am speaking through my son." Say, God speaking through us. And he said, "Ask of me, find out what I have determined to be so in the life of my sons." We are living according to our sonship reality. And I love the way Luke says it. The Bible said in Luke 15, 31, he says, "Son, you are with me always, and all that I have is yours." We've got to understand today that we have access to everything that belongs to the Lord. Come on, somebody say everything. Come on, y'all got to tell me everything. And notice something else he said. He says, son, you are with me always. And when we look up that word son in the Greek, it is the word technon. It means child. He said as long as that older son was acting like a child, he was trying to earn the provisions of the father, and he called that child behavior. And the Bible tells us as long as the heir, or long as the heir is, he's no different, as long as a son is acting like a child, he's no different from a slave. But I thank God that we understand our sonship reality. We are not trying to earn the provisions of God. We are receiving. We believe, therefore we speak according to what God has already given to us. Say, I already have everything. Come on, say, I have everything. Healing has already been given. Deliverance has already been given. And once I live in that reality, then he said, according to the work of my hands, you command me according to your sonship reality. See, if we don't speak, some of us are speaking as slaves. Slaves have no access. But a son has access. You don't have to wait for provision. You don't have to ask for father to do. It is no longer Lord, if you will. We already understand all things are already given. All things are already supplied. So I start commanding and things will manifest. Because the authority is in our mouth. So the Bible tells us, y'all all right with me this morning? John 14, watch this, and 10. The Bible says, did you not believe, Jesus, he's speaking as a son, watch this, that I am in the Father and the Father in me. He was talking oneness. That's where we are. We're one with them. Say we're one with God. And we're never separated. He said, do you not believe I'm in the Father and the Father's in me? He said, watch this. The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who what? Do y'all see that? The Father who dwells in me, what? Does the work. Oh, y'all got to see how he was functioning in the earth realm. He said, I'm not making it happen. I'm just speaking what the Father's already done. It's the Father who dwells. See, when I have the right words, I have the right results. He said, I don't speak what? On my own authority. Do y'all see that? But the Father who dwells in me does the work. Now notice something. Jesus tied the work and speaking together. Jesus said, I come to do the will of my Father and to finish his work. He tied the work and speaking together. Say, the work manifests after I speak. But the work does not need my ability. It needs my availability. In other words, when we speak what God has said according to his scripture and we declare it, then manifestation takes place. It is the return word that's not void. So let's go a little further with that. Watch this. Verse 12, John 12, 49 and 50. He said, for I have not spoken, Jesus again talking, on my own authority. We're about to see how he's speaking. He said that I don't speak my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the work. But then 12, 49, and 50, he says, for I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a what? Do y'all see that? He said, the Father who sent me gave me a command, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his command is everlasting life. Therefore, Jesus talking now, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak. Jesus said, I don't just speak on my own authority, but the Father has given me a command, and in his command is everlasting life. Life is in the command. So if I speak what he told me to say, there flows life. See, life, say life, everlasting life, perpetual life, life that can't be put out. It flows when I speak his command. And God said, I'm going to give you the command. You start talking. That's why it's so important that we function with the power of the sword in this season. Because as we're functioning with the power of the sword, we are releasing life in our atmosphere everywhere we turn. Say life, life, life. He said, in his word is life. And he said, in his word is life. And the life is the light of men. No, y'all not hearing me. He said, in my word is life. And the life is the light of men. And darkness cannot comprehend the light. Darkness cannot overcome the light. I don't care what's going on around you. Start commanding with the word. So he said, he tells me what to say, and then I start speaking. Jesus said he speaks the command of God and that he gives him to speak. And life is in the spoken command. When we speak the word, we release the power, as our man of God has taught, the power of the sword. See, we've gotten to the point to where we just come and hear word. Not in Beacon Light. We've gotten to the point where we are utilizing and speaking, and that's why things are manifesting all over the place. Oh, y'all don't hear me up in here. It's one thing to come, say, man of God, pray for me. It's another thing. We're not coming looking for prayer. We're coming with testimonies to the man of God. That's the church I want to be a part of. Not hearing me up in here. That's a paradigm shift. Something different is happening here. No, y'all not hearing me up in here. For so long, we have said, I got to call my pastor 3 o'clock in the morning. But you ain't calling him 3 o'clock in the morning. You taking your communion. You anointing with all. And God is manifesting, and he will continue to manifest power. It's in the word. We know who we are. So we release the life when we release the word. Jesus said the words, watch what Jesus said, the words that I speak are spirit and life. No, hear me. Not the word I heard. The word that I speak is spirit and life. Y'all remember the story? We want to look at this. I'm almost to where we want to end up because I just came here to make an announcement this morning. When we look at the 5th chapter of John, you remember about the man who was by the pool of Bethesda. And Jesus, he had been there for 30 years. Jesus said, rise, take up your bed and walk. For so long, he had been waiting for someone to help him or someone to do. Jesus, the grace came to him and said, rise, take up your bed and walk. He heard a word of grace. And what he had been waiting on happened immediately. The religious leaders were upset because he did this work on a Sabbath day. And they were upset and they were ready to deal with Jesus. And Jesus told them, in effect, what do you want me to do? You're not the authority over me. Like my little niece said when she was real young, she looked at somebody that wasn't her mother, and she said, "You're not the boss of me." Jesus said, "You're not my boss. I've been sent here." Oh, y'all got it. I need us to understand that we're not the boss of ourselves. We've been sent here. And he said, you don't control me. So John 5:17, look what Jesus said. Jesus said, but Jesus answered them, "My Father has been." No, y'all got to see that. My Father has what? Until now. And I have been. He told him. Remember, he tied work to speaking. He told him, take up your bed and walk. But he spoke a line to what he knew his Father had determined to be so in that moment. Because Jesus said, I can't say nothing unless I hear my Father saying it. And I can't do nothing unless I see my Father doing it. So Jesus was saying, I saw what my Father was doing in this moment. So I spoke. That's the command. And when he spoke a line to that, the man had no choice but to come up. Oh, I'm trying to tell you, I don't know what's been going on in your life, but when you see what the Lord is doing, that's why we say, Lord, give me the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you, that the eyes of my understanding will be enlightened, that I may know what is. Oh, this is a house that knows what is. I say this is a house that knows what is. So he's basically saying, you mean to tell me I can see what my daddy doing and you don't want me to do it? Therefore the Jews, verse 18, sought all the more to kill him because he was not only broke, he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. My God, we understand and we learn, our man of God taught us that in the old covenant, they couldn't call him Father. But we are new covenant believers. We are sons. Jesus was the only one who can call him Father. So now we say, Abba, Father. Daddy, come see and manifest what you've already determined to be so. Then Jesus answered, verse 19, watch this. And said to them, most assuredly I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he what? Sees the Father do. For whatever he does, the Son what? Also does in like manner. We know what the Father has done. He showed us all that he's done in Christ Jesus. And he's blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And now, as the Father has done, is now how we speak. We speak aligned to what Christ has done. I am redeemed. I am righteous. I am justified. I am never separated from God. I am eternally connected to God. I cannot be taken out of his hand. Forever is me and God, and I'm with him always. I don't have to earn nothing. It has been freely given to me, and that's how we speak. So he said, as he sees, when he sees the Father do, for whatever he does, the Son does also. As Christ is, so are we in this world. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that he himself does. Verse 20 says, what we see, this is important, y'all hear me. What we see and what we hear must be filtered through the word of God. No, y'all got to hear me right now. What we see and what we hear must be filtered through the word of God, because the Bible said the word is truth, and truth is what makes me free. So we go on, and I'm quickly to what I want to talk about. We just set it up with this. And so we understand that I'm speaking and declaring. I'm speaking and I'm declaring. The power of the sword. I'm speaking and I'm declaring. I'm speaking and I'm declaring. I'm declaring. I'm commanding what God has said to me. I'm declaring. No matter what's going on, no matter what's happening, I don't go by what I see, because what I see is temporary. I go by what he said. I say what he said, and I'm going to see what he said. Say, y'all not hearing me, what he said. Bishop stood here and said, Ayana is going to be singing here, and it won't be long. Where he now, we now saw what he said. Y'all not hearing me today? The Bible says in James 5:17, Elijah was a man. Talk about this in the last 10 minutes. With a nature like ours. And he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And of course, we're gonna leave some of this to my partner. He gonna deal with this a little bit more. He let him go into all the detail. I'm just here on an announcement. There's partners in this thing. Y'all don't hear me. I don't have to exhaust it all. I just came to announce something to the house. So the Bible says, y'all don't hear me up in here. The Bible says that when he spoke, it did not rain. He aligned what he said to the word of God. When you read in Deuteronomy 11, it is where they say, if you go after other gods, he said, I'm going to shut the rain down. And when I shut the rain down, your crops will not be able to yield. So Elijah knew that word, and he spoke according to that word. Say he spoke according to that word. And he declared to them, it's not going to rain till I tell it to rain. And he prayed again, verse 18 said, and the heaven gave rain. The word in 17 and 18, what he was doing was the word we've been learning, prosukamaye. To make a vow. Whoa, Lord, this sounds like this a word house. I mean, come on now. Come on, seriously, y'all. I'm being real right now. Don't play with me now, because y'all, come on. I got a few minutes, so y'all got to quickly come in agreement with me. Now, what church in America can you say prosukamaye and the people going to start about to be by praising? Sounds like it's a house that knows what is. To make a vow, a declaration toward God. One that he's spoken maybe in the ear. Or one he's allowed you to see through his word. But everything got a funnel. Come on now. Because they got some strange stuff happening. Not here. But it has to funnel through the word of God. Watch this. Through the lens of the new covenant. Everywhere he say, I will, the wills are out. The ifs are out. He's already done it. He said to make a vow, a declaration to God, a declaration with regard to the word of God. This type of praying allows us to avail much. Great power producing great results. No. Great power producing great results. Praying this way placed Elijah in a commanded atmosphere. Somebody said placed him in a commanded atmosphere. Praying this way. He was making declarations toward God. Declarations with regard to God's word. He was a man with a nature. I love the way it said with a nature like ours. So all it's telling us is if we follow the pattern, prosukamaye, open our mouth. And our man of God taught us the only answer for suffering is prosukamaye. Suffering comes to an end when I say what God has said about me in his word. Great power, great results. Praying this way placed Elijah in a commanded atmosphere. And God told me to announce, Beacon Light of Houma is now living in a commanded atmosphere. I really just came to tell you that. All that to say, Beacon Light of Houma is living in a commanded atmosphere. Now, can I define commanded atmosphere? It is an atmosphere where nothing or no one can deny you what God has released in your life through the finished work of Jesus Christ. I come to tell us how you can't be denied. There was famine in the land. And he told us there was famine in the land. Do y'all hear me? But the famine was in the entire land. But watch this. It was in the entire land, famine, but it wasn't where Elijah was abiding. No. I'm trying to tell you what's on you. Don't you let the news talk to you. Don't you let what you see talk to you. You've got to understand this house, under this word, using their sword in this season, is in a commanded atmosphere, and that is a place called there. Somebody say there. Elijah was famine everywhere, but not where he was, because he was working with the word. He was working with the word. And whenever we are working with the word, we will always remain in a place called there. I'm about to get out your way. 1 Kings 17:2. Then the word of the Lord came to him saying, get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherry, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. You can't be over here. That's why I understand what God was doing to me. It was this time last year, Bishop McClendon walked out of the office and he told Bishop Andrew. Bishop Andrew didn't even remember that. So it was for me to hear. He said, I hear a stampede of people coming into this house. And he said, I got a word that I gotta give you. And when he said that, the Lord told me, and I want you here too. Well, a year later, here I stand. I'm in my And the Bible says, so he did what the Lord said. And the ravens brought him bread. And he drunk, oh, y'all don't hear me. The ravens brought him meat, a stingy bird brought it because he was there. And that what you wouldn't think, a scavenger bird was bringing him his provision because he was. Oh, y'all gotta hear me today. Then all of a sudden it dried up. But then the word of the Lord came to him. Go to Zarephath. I've commanded a widow to feed you. All he had to do was get to Zarephath, and the provision was gonna flow. I don't know who I'm talking to, but when you live in your, this house is, we no longer on the way. No, y'all got to hear me today. You're no longer on the way you are. Bible said, the woman said, I ain't got that much. I don't have enough. I'm about to die. She had no hope. Then the Bible said, Elijah told her, make me a cake first. And the woman said, well, I don't have what you're talking about. And so the Bible said, he said to her, and Elijah said to her, verse 13, do not fear. Go and do what you say, but make me a small cake first and bring it to me. And afterward, make some for yourself and your sons. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up. The jar of oil shall not run out until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. So she went and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her household ate for many days. Oh, then the bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. Can I announce to you, Beacon Life, there is an authority in your word. There is power in your word. There is healing in your word. Speak it, and manifestations will take place. And I declare over this house, there is no lack in this house. I declare we're in there. I declare we live there. Don't let the economy talk to you. Don't let yourself talk to you. Don't let your unbelieving family talk to you. You speak back and declare. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we glorify you. We honor you for the commanded atmosphere. It is a place where nothing or no one can deny us. And because of the evening sacrifice, hear me, people of God, in the famine, he sustained them until the rain came. Once the rain came, the earth can do what it needed to do. I declare there is a sound of abundance of rain. I say there's a sound of abundance of rain. So even now, we decree, we declare. We don't need emotion. We just need faith to believe, and we speak. We don't need our emotions stirred. Our faith has been raised in the finished work of Jesus Christ. So we declare the commanded atmosphere is where we live. Nothing or no one can deny us what God has for us. No lack, come on. Abundance is here. It's not coming, I say it's here. Access it with your words. Somebody say access it with your word. Now come on, give God some praise.
Your grace, for your mercy has renewed my faith. I have overcome.
Hallelujah. Come on, y'all, everybody declare, I receive. Hallelujah.
I have overcome.
Yes.
The
everybody shout one word, and that word is there. Hallelujah. Because of what God has put on each and every one of you, there's no devil, no demon in hell that can stop you when you operate with the commanded word in the commanded atmosphere. Will y'all bless God for my brother, Bishop Edward Pierce? Hallelujah. Come on, we're getting ready to baptize these candidates, but I need everybody to say, I receive.
I receive your grace.
Hallelujah.
For your mercy,
deacons.
For your mercy has renewed.
Hallelujah.
My
come on.
I have overcome.
Hallelujah. The world. Hallelujah. Can we position the candidates in place, please? Hallelujah.
I receive your grace, for your mercy has renewed my faith. I have overcome the world. I receive your grace, for your mercy.
The family, those who's being baptized, if you would like to come closer up. Families, again, please come closer up if you would like to witness.
Hallelujah. Why don't you help us praise God for all of these souls as they go down in the liquid grave. Say, Lord, you are good today.
Lord, you are good and your mercy enduring forever.
Lord, you are so good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy enduring forever.
Say, Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good you and are your mercy good. Enduring forever.
Say, Lord, you are so good.
God, who's being baptized today, for what you've already done inwardly, we thank you, Lord, that this is a symbol of their outward confession of their faith. So we thank you and pray that you will trouble the water. In Jesus' name we pray and baptize them in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit.
People from every nation
and tongue,
from generation,
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 we love.
Good all the time.
family, we have anniversary gifts for each of you as you're leaving out on the round tables. Please make sure you take advantage of that. We are so, so, so excited how far God has brought us. And now may the Lord God go with you and be with you as we continue to pursue Maya all throughout today and this week. In Jesus' name, be blessed.
You are good all the time and all the time.